Alright, Volkswagen's coming along. Joe's doing a steering column in a Toyota. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, I'm Jimmy, making it work. I'm glad you're here. We're going to spend a day in the shop. Fixing cars, getting engines installed in Volkswagens, maybe a classic GTO or a Chevy truck or so. We'll see if I get the GTO or someone else does. But, oh, those are the steering columns that Joe's doing in a Toyota. Toyotas never break though. You guys know how I feel about that. A mechanical thing is a mechanical thing, regardless of what brand you prefer. And I have my favorites. Beautiful morning, 49 degrees, although I am wearing the shorts, just to turn up the sexy. And mostly because it's supposed to be 76 degrees later on today. I'm gonna start off a little chilly and it'll be beautiful later on. I also know I don't have to roll around the ground putting that engine in anymore. Most of the hard stuff's done. Probably shouldn't have said that. We just gotta do some final wiring connections and a couple of little things and we'll be done. So matter of fact, I think Joe's got this eco boom just about done too. He was running last night, so let's put in some clips right here so you'll know what's going to go on in this video. Skip ahead if you don't want to know. You want it to be a surprise. I think Bill's daycare caught on fire, so you guys can see behind me how beautiful it is out this morning. We got sunrise just a little while ago. We got clear skies. It's gonna be a nice day. Hopefully it'll also be a very busy day because I show 14 hours on the labor clock so far for the week. But I do have a few vehicles haven't been picked up, and if I can get that engine done, you guys been watching a while, you know when I'm doing a big repair, I tend to go a little slower. I'd rather lose a little time than have to do it twice. That being said, we're using salvage turbo and a salvage engine. So we'll see how it goes. I'm always optimistic that it's going to work out, and sometimes I'm right. Let's try to learn a thing or two. Have some fun. Stay tuned. Uh-oh, we got a man down. I think Bill's daycare caught on fire, so he had to stay home with his youngin'. So we're going to get this fan bolted up, get some more things done, try to get this thing running. We got a bunch of work to do. I got the water outlet housing and hoses on that Hyundai. And then there's another one that needs a hub bearing and something else. And then, of course, the GTO. I know if I get to work on this one, I got to put this ground, a nut on this ground. I know we'll definitely be making a head start. The phone! I hear today's first alarm in the distance. Always want to hear that click. Same thing on the hoses. Clicking these hoses on. Sorry if I'm making you dizzy. There's a little spring clip on here. You slide it out to pull them off. I always slide it back before I put it on. That way when I'm sliding it together, I hear that good snap. Then of course I'll tug it backwards, make sure it's stuck on there good. Where does this go, you know? I need to know. You guys need to help me out here. This goes somewhere. We got a couple things we got to figure out here still. Can't go too far. Oh, you know what? I think there's another duct here and it probably goes on that boost sensor or something. This is gonna go all the way up on a throttle body. And then there's a boss here and a boss up there for the screws. Not that they're trying to get 5 pounds of dookie in a 2 pound bag, but yeah, okay, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to get 5 pounds in a 2 pound bag. That's that. Put them screws in, one more rubber hose, and the turbo tubers are hooked up. Snug this one, or start it at least, and then I can do this one. Can't see it. I'm working on it. Where is it? Need an extension. Thank you. Appreciate that. Now, this one little elbow. You see all these ribs? These are designed to bite really good. Because when it's making boost, rather than vacuum in here, pulling air in, the turbocharger is pushing air and is actually pressure. And if these aren't on there good, they'll pop apart. Like, I have to remember to go up there and tighten that upper clamp. I push this on from the bottom. So when I let the car down, first thing I'm gonna do, tighten that clamp. Otherwise, first time you accelerate, it'll build boost and go poof and push it off. And you'll be like, oh, I got a boost code, no power. Of course, we'll tighten these lower ones first. It's one of the hardest things I had to learn when I was a young mechanic, because something pops in your head you want to take care of and you stop what you were doing and then you forget. And you're like, I don't know how I forgot that. It's because you're trying to do everything at once. So I learned not to skip around. If it's avoidable. Of course, the clamp is right in the absolute worst spot. I think I want to say I got this with a flat blade screwdriver because I couldn't get it any other way. Finagle this. You know how to finagle stuff? Nope. Okay. So what I'll do instead is take these two screws out. Volkswagen. And this clamp is pinched into the rubber with staples. So you can't relocate it, put it in a decent spot where you can get to it. Because Hans and Franz, when this car is manufactured, that gets connected before this ever goes on. Doesn't matter. Overflow goes to that one. Get out of the way, will you? Oh, that's like a... That's the purge hose. I guess it has to go under that. It's not in the bracket anymore. Looks like it hasn't been. I didn't pull it out, but we'll fix that too as need be. Oh my goodness, it has to go through it. That makes sense. Let's go through it. Two screws in the back. This has abrasion covering on it, so it can lay on that aluminum, I think. All right, I'm gonna tighten this first. That's all there is to it. It wants to be a pain in the patootie. There's only so many things you can hold at one time. There you go, that's better. I pushed this stupid rubber thing back on this lip like 10 times and I keep doing it. I don't know why I can't just leave it, but clamp's all buttoned up. Drain plug, I think they left it loose from the salvage yard. So we're gonna go look at that. I found, I had one little connector I couldn't find. It went down to the turbo underneath this little hose. So I got that taken care of. We're closing in on the home stretch. I think I could put the battery tray in. The shifter linkage is back on, two clips. No bolts for that part. I gotta do those heater hoses. Aha! I knew there was something back there before the battery tray goes in. Do one at a time so I can get my hose clamp cable pull back here. Probably still can't see anything from there, but we'll see in editing. And make sure it's on now. The clamp's kind of holding it, but now I gotta release this little lever. I gotta squeeze it some more. Release the lever. Something like that, I think. It's the problem with a job you're working on for a week. Sometimes things slip your memory. Now I've looked over all of this as I go. Double and triple check connections and hose clamps, made sure they're all on. And I'll probably still do it again. That's pretty close. Get my battery. Now I can put my heat wrap dealio in there before I put the terminals on.
Good?
Depends on who you ask. Getting ready to put this air box in, and I see this connector down here. It's not been on anything in a while, and I see a stand here. It's almost like an air temp sensor is missing. It's not in the air box. The only thing the air box has is this hose here goes to it. Obviously it connects to the inlet, and this is a little scooper dealio that goes here. So there's a sensor that's been missing, it looks like. We'll have to pay attention when we're done, see if we get an ambient air temp code and a check engine light. It's going to be at minus 40 degrees. That's usually what they go to when they're open. Oh yeah. Icon ratchet's been pretty good. 2 years old now. Snaps together. Kind of strange it's open back here. You would think something would block that off in the engine compartment. Maybe it's high performance heat induction. That's the kind of cool stuff I like. They got a stopper so you can't put a funnel in it. But little do they know, I have a funnel that fits the hole almost perfectly. They want you to buy a screw-on funnel that has a Volkswagen end. You guys keeping it family friendly. All right, I got the good stuff going in this. The ticket just says motor oil. So I looked it up. It's a 530 or 540 euro. We're going with 5.8 quarts of AMS oil. The best money can buy, in my opinion. Some say it's not as good as it used to be. People that regularly change their oil, most important. And if you regularly change it with AMS oil, I'm rarely ever fixing those engines. So, coincidence? Possibly. I don't know. But years ago, I sent multiple oil samples out for testing, and the AMS oil kicked everything else's butt, even Mobile 1. And Mobile 1 came in second. So, racing oils like Red Line and Royal Purple are really good too. But the Royal Purple will dye your engine parts purple, which is kind of strange, but it's a good oil though. Just wish they didn't have quite so much dye in it. That should do it. I gotta put coolant in it too. And let that funnel drip a minute. Let's see what this here Earl looks like. Nice. Perfect. I'm gonna have to check it again. Might need another little tiny bit of oil once the oil filter cavity is full. You can put the AC machine on this and get the AC system in a vacuum too. Uh-oh, that can't happen. Let's go this way. That's better. Let's try to sort out this mess. This goes this way. This goes this way. This goes this way.
What are you tearing apart?
Air conditioning machine.
All the wheel tubs back there.
Huh?
All the wheel tubs back there.
The wheel tubs are the wheel liners for this car.
Oh, you put a motor in it?
Yep.
Oh boy. Blow it up?
Oh yeah, it's a Volkswagen.
Where the hell did you find a motor at for this?
Junkyard. So we took the junk motor out, put another junk motor in. Hopefully one that runs. The engine cost us $4,600 used.
Yeah.
So we make less margin than we normally do.
Yeah.
We take way more responsibility because you put an engine in someone's car, they think they have a new car.
Yeah.
I got my window.
Oh, you own it now.
My window doesn't work since you worked on it.
Yeah, you own it now. For sure. Definitely own it now.
That's the hard part. And I'm going to lose time on it. The shop's not going to make the margin it normally does. But we were a little slow, so we sold it and did it.
I would drive it home. And I tell the customer, you know, hey, I need to put some miles on it. You know, I'm going to drive it home. You know, let it sit overnight. Go out there and make sure ain't nothing dripping, you know.
Something's leaking.
Oh yeah, you got a dripper. Not gonna be a freeze plug that you can't get to.
Well, there's all kinds of stuff apart. I gotta see what's leaking. Well, that's not desirable. I can't even see where it's coming from, but it's somewhere in the oil cooler bracket, which we put a new gasket on there. I didn't disturb the other side. The tube that connects it to the other plastic part is dry. So something's going on with the bracket. Okay, I'm gonna take it all back apart. So I'm gonna pull the compressor and the alternator back out. I'll probably take the cooling fans back out so I can get in there a little easier and see what we can find. Very discouraged right now. I don't see anything wrong. I don't know why it's leaking. All the O-rings are good. Nothing moved out of place. Could it be a head gasket? But I don't see any moisture above the gasket. I'm wondering if I gotta put it in, try tightening it more, seeing if that has any effect. What do you guys think? I'm wondering if I tighten the lower bolts on this bracket, they kind of brace it. I wonder if I tighten them too soon or something. I went and looked in the procedure. It doesn't mention tightening these only first and then the bottom, but I probably already did that. I'm not sure. I have to look back when I edit this video and you guys will see with me. I'll show you guys however it was, but maybe I tighten the bottom ones first and there's no gasket down there, so I shouldn't have done that. Maybe, I don't know. It's the only thing I can think of why it was leaking. Put another gasket in it, put a little silicone on it too. Put it back together, see what happens. I'm gonna tighten the bottom two now. I can put coolant in it, test it before putting everything else back in and see. Those lower bolts last. Now we get some coolant. Nope, still leaking. That's terrible. That means I'm on the wrong path. It's not coming from that bracket, I guess. It's coming from some of these new parts someone else put in before this car went to the junkyard, before this engine went to the, they like to call it salvage. But it's not coming from what I worked on, so I took that off for nothing. I thought everything looked okay, but I was swearing it was coming from here and everything looked dry. But with the alternator and compressor, you can't see anything. There's so much junk. It's like Volkswagen's version of an EcoBoost. So, whatever this housing is under the intake, I'm gonna have to do. I think I might just pull the intake off so I can get a better look at it and see what's leaking 100%. And we can order that and go from there. Cool. I like snowballs, delicious. Especially if you put some flavored juice on them, like raspberry, cherry, they're delicious. All right, intake's off. That is a ton of fun, if you wonder. Highly recommend it to anyone who's a Volkswagen fan. And, you wanna see where it's leaking? I guess I could take some of the blame, but. Someone has loosened the bolts. And just loosened the bolts and left it like that. So, could I just tighten the bolts? Probably. Will I just tighten the bolts? No. How do I know there's a gasket in there now? So I have to take all that off and figure it out. So maybe I'll just have them get me that housing, whatever that's a water pump housing, I think. The 17-hour job now is going on 22 hours, so. Anyway, enough about that. I got a hub bearing to do, I think. Yeah, there should be just some torques to get that housing off of there. Oh, look, they went through the trouble of putting a temp thing on it, so we know if it got overheated with the bolts they left loose. I don't know what the plan is, but carrying on, because that's what we do. We carry on, get it done, figure it out, make it work, get past it, go on to the next one. No big deal. Frustrating, yeah, but it's just always been this way. It's what we do. And people say, how much? Well, a mechanic gets about $500 for this job. It's $11,000. I like the way they come up with this stuff, man. It's cool. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. Well, you know, a Rector set up. I think this is way past an erector set myself, but there's gotta be another bolt hidden somewhere. All right, let me look around some more. Suddenly I remembered, oh, you gotta think like an Audi. There's a belt, it's a belt-driven water pump. It's not electric, even if it looks it. So you gotta take the belt off, silly. How can you just remove a water pump without taking the drive belt off? Now it'll come off. Oh, shouldn't have said nothing. Yeah, they just loosen the bolts. Let me ask them up front if they want to at least get gaskets for this, and then we'll put it all back together. That's 4 hours I'll never get back. Should have probably put all new stuff on it anyway. Well, that's where the cover goes. The water pump feels like it's okay, but how do we know? All right, we'll I wanted to get this to a point where I could let them know what we might need. Let them decide from there, and we'll start on a hub bearing. Not supposed to do that. It's pretty funny. This is the one you guys might remember. This car I looked at a couple weeks ago. I said, that thing's gonna need a hub bearing, and we told her, don't drive it. Of course, she drove it, but now we're gonna fix it. You're gonna get me a gasket for that Volkswagen water pump housing, and then we'll carry on with that one. It should have been done like an hour or two ago, but because the junkyard loosened the bolts, or somebody loosened the bolts and just left it in place, I'm not checking for tight bolts on a salvage engine that was supposedly pulled out of a running car. So now I got even less faith that that engine's going to be okay, but we got to forge ahead. We'll get it back together and see. Oh, this looks like a fairly new hub already. Well, that's terrible. Someone has ground the axle down. All right, carry on. Nothing to see here.
Uh-oh. That's not going to work. Can't say I didn't try.
Ah, complete. Not tight. That's right. You know what? Let me tight when we're done. That's what's important. Makes me wonder if this is tight. Probably isn't. But the damage is done to the bearing already, so let's see if the bottom caliper works.
Try this on here.
We'll try an extension. See if we can get something going. Wasn't very tight either. Okay. They weren't like falling out loose. They just, it's like someone turned them in by hand and stopped and forgot or something. I don't know. Come here, will you? Trying to get something done this week. I'm going to have like a 17-hour week if the Volkswagen doesn't go. And it's not looking good. So, what are you going to do? All right, come on, man. You are absolutely killing me, bro. Thank you. Appreciate you. Oh my goodness. Gravity check. Oh. Apparently this was done here a couple years ago by someone that no longer works here. So we're going to do it under warranty now. So this is bad. All right, we're going to, we're nervous too about what else might be going on in the mess. So they want me to go through it, put the new parts in, make sure everything's good. I guess everyone's doing the best they can, but if this is the best you can, don't be a mechanic. Just let someone else do it. Or get with Rain Man Ray or Eric O or Jimmy Making It Work. And I get some tips here and there and be safe. You know what I'm saying? Look at that cotter pin work. That is nice. All right, carry on. What a freaking week. I'm just going to give you a little tip. Whether you put in a new one or a used one, that's not how it goes. So that is not how it goes. The good news is whoever did this doesn't work here anymore. That part I'm happy about, because it was up to me and I found this. They wouldn't work here now. It's unacceptable. Not the cotter pin, but not tightening the axle nut. I mean, a lot of people don't like to torque them. They insist they're magicians and they can feel 144 foot-pounds versus 176. That's on you, but to not tighten it at all, yeah, that's not good. That actually, more than making me sad, it makes me mad, so that's not good. You don't want to see me angry. What does he say before he becomes the green guy? Bill Bixby. All right, I need both hands to get this out, and I'm going to just get a torch in a second, so I'll give you guys a break. We'll come back, and that'll be out like magic. Yeah, that one was tight, at least. It wasn't, like, really tight, but it was
It was kind of tight. Usually when a cotter pin won't fit through the hole. What the heck? That was pretty funny. I got a washer in my pocket and my new camera mount stuck to the washer. And it really tried to pull my shirt off. That's a, the magnet on this thing is crazy. You want to see it? Look at that thing. It's crazy. This thing was snug, but not tight. And the only way a cotter pin doesn't fit in the hole is if the cotter pin's either too large a diameter or if the nut's not tight enough to be past it more. So I'm not sure what happened with this car. Like I said, this might be just the wrong nut because it I don't know. Yeah, it's in there snug. So, okay. Can't say they left that loose. I can just say they used the wrong nut or the wrong cotter pin or both. Little tap of the hammer, that'll come right out. You don't believe me? Told you. We're getting into strut area. This is gonna be like a 18 or something. And he's got some big nuts on the other side there. It's like a 22 or so on the other side. I gotta get a wrench. Alrighty then. 15/16 is what I grabbed just on a whim, and he's right. I think it's about the same as 24 millimeter, that's all. But I didn't have a 24 millimeter in my cart. Gravity check! A lot of gravity checks this week. You guys are falling over too. You got. Gotta lay off the sauce. I don't know how many times I gotta tell you. These little dealios don't hold the weight of the camera great. But other than that, this thing's pretty cool. We'll have some fun with it. Back to our regularly scheduled nonsense for the week. I gotta take this. Oh, this is on the strut. Okay, I just gotta take the ABS as a 10. So let's go ahead and set one of those up. Oh, Monday, gotta look out. I'm gonna tell you guys who wins the Super Clean giveaway. That'll be on Monday's video. I'll announce the winner. I've put comments under videos to let people know, but they don't seem to always go back and read them. I guess YouTube doesn't notify everybody. Fast and Furious Ford Fiesta. ST. I want to support you guys for supporting me, and I want to help you avoid scammers at the same time. Scammers are the worst kind of criminals of all. They don't even have the decency to try to rob you in person. Back to what I was saying, I will mention in the video when I do the drawing, I'll mention in the video who wins so they know to go look for the comment or to email me either way. I'll pin the comment to that video so that they'll know they won if YouTube sends them a notification, and they'll know they won if they watch my videos continually and not just the one that I was giving something away. Because I've given a couple things away and never heard from the people who won them. I don't like that, but I just wish I had time to go looking back through all the comments over and over again, but I don't. So I'm doing what I have to do. This is going to be looks like a 15. And we'll have this knuckle off of here. I got to take the axle nut back off. And we'll take the same over to the press. I'm not sure what I'll be able to do with this, but we'll see. Not sure why the axle was so boogered up, it came right out. You turned yourself on while I was gone. Cool. That is cool. GoPro. GoPro. Sometimes you just gotta get mad and they pop right out. I try to baby it out and convince it to come out and ask it to come out. And it just shoots me down. So then I make it come out and things change. I can't wait till this week is over. Just saying. Can't wait. I have had enough ball joints. Doesn't have any axial play, but radial. Woo! The next phase in the operation is to get the hub out of the bearing. And since we got a cool kit, it comes with not only a new bearing, it comes with a new hub. Now that is how you do it. You don't have to try to get the race off the inner bearing to reuse the hub. I normally do. I normally just heat it up and get it to come off pretty easily. Although, it's more work, a little bit of a hassle. Oh, we got parts. Just gotta get this separated. They usually pop out a little easier than that. I should have probably slide hammered this off what was on the car, but I figured I would just pop it out. And it's not popping out. I'm gonna set up a slide hammer. Putting it back together, I can use the press and not have to worry about doing any more damage. I'm really worried about that metal splash shield, but we're gonna rock it. I don't want to take it off completely, and it wasn't making any noise before, just the wheel was loose. Now I can push this back together. I just got these two blocks of steel under the cast iron spindle. Once this is all the way in, I'll put the hub underneath it and support it by something so the lug nuts don't get pushed out. I'll show you. There's a ridge for the snap ring. Should be good. Get the snap ring, make sure that goes in. I prefer it as a sharp edge and a rounded edge. These are stamped, so I prefer to put the sharp edge facing up so it's caught in this ridge and kind of helps hold itself together, but probably get my straight snap ring pliers because of the way this one's snap shaped is different than the original one. Make sure it's seated. I just got to get the hub. One of the things I like about this spacer, even though it's rusty, fits right in there. So now the studs won't get pushed out when you put it together. Put a little bit of wheel bearing grease on there, just to help in the reassembly. Some people like that, some people don't. It doesn't hurt anything. So I hope it doesn't make anyone sad. Now, this might be, perfect. Same thing going together. Now we wanna hold everything nice and straight. Keep your face and fingers away. Everything is lined up as centered as you can. And don't try to help it while it's going together. Gotta tighten this back up though. If it's not straight, it'll straighten it out in a hurry.
sound will change when it's bottomed. That's it. Now, of course, when you torque the axle nut, you can be certain that it's seated all the way. But you can also see, if you look in there at that gap, pocket screwdriver will barely fit in there. So it's not much more for it to go. So we know we're really close, if not bottomed out completely. As soon as you hear the press start to struggle, basically bottomed out. You gotta put the snap ring in first so it doesn't push the bearing out while you're pushing the hub in, right? Little ABS deal. He's gonna be happy to be home. Oh man. You gotta watch your 10 millimeters. They'll get away every opportunity they get. Sneaky little son of a guns. Axle nut. Oh look, came with a new nut too. Did I show you that yet? That's exciting. Now, since this has been pretty boogered up, I'm gonna have to find my threads really gently. These axles come out pretty easily, so I'm guessing someone boogered the threads up, cross-threading it on, but I'm not sure. Pure speculation. I don't want to duplicate the problem because quarter inch of threads are already missing. I might have to get one of my thread chaser tools out here. Let's see. Can't do it by hand. Probably no good. I'm gonna have to get a thread file. Got these thread cleaning dies. They will clean metal out of the axle rather than making it worse. Oh, that was nothing. Should have forced the nut on. Dang it. That's all right. That was the right way to do it, Jimmy. Why does it look like it's straight? But it certainly doesn't feel like it is. And there's a little bit of carnage going on in there still. Run this a couple times in and out. What's the word, Thunderbird?
It is. Very nice.
Sure wish this axle wasn't boogered.
You got a welder, right?
I got a welder. We'll weld it in.
Make it work, Jimmy.
That's what we're gonna have to do. Weld it in, make it work. My chasing die goes right on.
Right on.
It's almost like someone's trying to tell me not to use my nuts. I go get the old nut out of the scrap pile. That's what I gotta do. Put it on backwards, see how it goes. Yeah, same thing. Is this the right nut? I'm so lost this week. I can't wait for it to be over. Let's start again Monday.
Yeah, it'll buff.
It seems like it will. That's what the last guy said. Told you, just do it. Stop being nice about it. I spent 5 minutes on that because I didn't want to hurt anything worse than it already has been. I'm gonna put a little torque action on that. Then I'll put a divot in the nut wherever it ends up. It's probably pretty tight, but I wanna check and see about where it's at. Put the 14 back on here. I got a new cotter pin and everything. This is a lock nut, so it probably doesn't even really have to have a cotter pin, depending on who you ask. Some vehicles come with lock nuts, some use cotter pins. I still gotta finish bolting up the strut. I'm gonna put the brakes on it. Yeah, I might need to go to this next smaller cotter pin. But since I already have this one out here, it's gonna take a lot to make me give up.
It's agonizing watching, isn't it? I feel like I'm watching Rain Man Ray now. Just kidding. It's so weird that it wiggles. It should go in the hole, shouldn't it? This is why the last guy gave up and said, I don't care, I'll just stick one side in, I don't care. I'm not gonna do that though. I'm at least care enough to make it like even from left to right. Now at that point, I don't care. Okay, maybe I care a little. This was all bent, I had to bend it back. There was a heck of a lip on here. That's why I had a hard time getting the pads and caliper off, but we're not doing brakes. Someone already did it. Pad slap, which I wouldn't do a pad slap on something that bad, but when the rotor's in good shape, I don't have a problem with it. The rotor's in bad shape, it needs rotors. Seems pretty simple to me, but not hitting that hard at all. Save the pickle juices. Don't smash stuff with your hands. A little tighter it was before, but this one, I can do power tools with that one. 214 foot labs. I don't like to do this trick. Everyone always keeps saying, you know, you could put a screwdriver in the rotor, but I don't like to do it. I'm gonna do it this time though, just to save some time. Don't do it unless you have a really good screwdriver, and don't forget to turn your torque wrench on. It was at probably about 60 foot-pounds before. Someone said, I can do it by feel, I don't need to torque it. Okay. There you go. Where are we at? 216, I went over just a teeny bit. That's all right. It's within the margin of error. Put my torque wrench down. I usually keep it around 90 in my toolbox. Most vehicles, that's going to cover. I won't have to go far in either direction. Don't forget your screwdriver. Suck going down the road. Now, main reason I did it that way, so I'm taking the wheel back off to pinch this over. I'm going to get the wheel on this. Take it for a drive. I'm going to probably go back on that Volkswagen and see what we can get done today. Back to the drawing board. Now there's a lot of stuff going on in here. All because of Hans and Franz. They thought, you know what? This is the best way to do this. This is top notch. There's no other manufacturer that can reach the standard we've set. And I think they're pretty much right. So now the belt's on. So now I gotta slide it onto the plastic tube that comes off the oil cooler dealio. And there's a couple of pins in the block. Once you get it slid up on there enough, you don't want the bolts to catch. You gotta kind of keep the bolts from catching while you move it over. Then you can start the bolts. One of the best setups you could possibly have, I think. In the real world, as you gain experience, they make things more complicated. So you feel like you're always behind. Someone's happy about it, I guess. I need a shorter extension. There was also only one bolt in this. This one was missing. So I got a bolt from the other engine. From the same location, just in case the length's different. Where is it? See it in there? There it is. Let's see here. Oh my goodness gracious, why is it not?
Oh my goodness. Does this really make sense to somebody? I don't think it's this filler, this air nozzle thing, but it could be. Maybe it is. Something happened. Oh my goodness, even that won't reach because of this. Gonna help out Hans and Franz. Little American ingenuity. There you go. I don't wanna hear it. At this point, this has been apart so many times that the clips aren't really doing their doodle. So the clipper doodles now, they're just faux clips, I would guess you would call them. F-A-U-X. Got a new oil filter to put in this thing. Got a new O-ring on it. There you go. Switch. Don't break the switch. Battery might even be dead. I'm not sure. I gotta check it. I don't remember where it was at when we last met. Coolant appears to be staying in there, so that's good. I'm just about ready to fire this up. I'm not sure if I have the nerve. Let me contemplate it a minute and we'll see what happens. Giving it a thrice over, belts on, all that stuff's on. I don't think I've missed anything. It's holding coolant. I'm feeling brave. We're gonna fire this thing up and see what happens. I didn't evacuate the AC and fill it yet. My optimism has been challenged, and it takes a lot for that to happen. Now keep in mind too, I'm not sure if I told you guys this yet. Funny story, they had an extended warranty and they tried to get it covered by that and they declined it. Apparently this customer bought this car over 2 years ago and just put it in their yard and let it sit. It's gone like 11 miles since it was bought 2 years ago. And they tried to get the engine covered by the extended warranty, and the extended warranty said you haven't drove it. You bought it and parked it. So that problem had to be pre-existing. So they declined it. Anyway, I thought that was interesting. It runs for the first time in 2 years. It's mad about something. I gotta put more coolant in it. I'm gonna put the AC machine on it, start evacuating it. All right. Thing actually runs pretty good. I'm happy about that, but every light in the dash is on. Car's been sitting a while. It's got the low fuel light on, all that stuff. So I'm gonna do some updates on the Phoenix Light 2. We're gonna get those updates done. And then we're gonna go in here, clear all the codes, because we got a new engine. We might have to do like a throttle relearn or a crank relearn, things like that. I'm gonna have to look and see. And I'm definitely gonna record the codes, then erase them and see what comes back. That's the easiest way to see what kind of codes are current, what's going on right now. Everything looks like it's plugged in. I gave it another once over, three or four another once overs. So that's a good thing. Successfully installed, auto scan. Let me get this all loaded up and I'll clear the codes. We'll come back, see what codes come back, and we'll go over those. Code I'm getting is engine coolant temperature, and it's right there in the radiator. It's showing minus 36 degrees, which means it's not plugged in, but it's plugged in. That's the problem. So I'm going to try wiggling it, and we'll see if something happens.
Yes, son.
Yeah, I'm checking codes.
Hey, with it unplugged and with it plugged in, I get the same reading. Well, that's strange. So the next course of action is to jump it out with a paper clip and we'll watch the data and see what happens.
Yeah, okay. Or it just shut off everything.
There it goes, hot.
It was on and off.
Let's plug this back in.
When it acts up, it'll say collision avoidance disabled. No, because it's through. So it does say that.
84. So this temperature 16 sensor, there must be a secondary coolant temperature sensor, which is probably one of these up here in this filter housing because it's cooling out oil here. So one of these is probably for that. I'm going to see, I'm guessing this one's oil.
Can you pull this Camaro around?
I'm going to unplug this one. That's a single wire. That is unusual. So what I'll do is, I'm not pushing this into the, you don't want to damage the terminals, so I'm just touching it to it and then grounding it. I want to see if my data changes, if I'm on the right sensor. It doesn't. So this sensor is not what I was thinking it was. Let me find out where temperature 16 signal 10 sensor, which is right here. I'm going to find out where that thing is, because the one on the hose reads correctly. There's another sensor in the back of the cylinder head here. Does the same thing. Remember this one I was talking about not being plugged in anywhere? To look and see if I'm on the right sensor. It's a little guy down there. Usually larger than that. I'm gonna have to look into this a little bit more. Okay, so hear me now, believe me later. I took the coolant temp sensor out of the other motor and plugged it in and cleared the code. The code goes away. So the sensor in this motor is bad. So we're going to pop that in Monday. Let it cool off a little bit. It didn't get too hot. But that's why when it was running, it would just crank the fans on. And it was very upset. Because the salvage motor has a bad coolant temp sensor. Well, I hope it wasn't as stressful of a week for you guys as it was for me. Because I wouldn't want that. I'd rather have you subscribing and torquing like buttons and leaving comments about how great the video was. But we did what we can. I'm not even going to look at my hours. This car's not going until Monday. But I'll tell you what, next week's going to be a really awesome week because this car will be on it. And they said they'd take care of me on the hours for the troubles and stuff like that. But I feel kind of responsible because I should have dismantled the entire salvage engine and assumed everything was going to be messed up. But it's my constant positivity that gets me in a bind sometimes. I just figure everything's going to be great because I want it to be. Anyway, I've enjoyed your company. I've enjoyed having you around all week, and especially in this video right here. And I hope I'll see you in the next one, because you're awesome.